What if the oldest guide to death was actually a map of the universe? For over 1,000 years, monks in the Himalayas have recited verses from a text so mysterious, so layered in symbolism, that scholars have argued for centuries about what it truly means. The Bardo Thodol, known in the West as the Tibetan Book of the Dead, it describes what happens between heartbeats, between lives, in the space where consciousness unravels. But in early 2024, something unprecedented happened. A quantum AI system, built to simulate the behavior of subatomic particles, was given access to the complete manuscript, not just to translate the words, but to decode the structure beneath them. What it found wasn't mysticism, it was mathematics. And the implications are just beginning. The Bardo Thodol was written in the 8th century by Padmasambhava, a Buddhist master who reportedly hid the teachings in secret places, caves, cliffs, even inside the minds of his disciples, to be revealed only when humanity was ready. It was rediscovered in the 14th century, translated into English in 1927, and misunderstood ever since. Western scholars called it a death manual, a guide to be read aloud to the dying, describing the stages of dissolution, the body shutting down, the mind unraveling, the soul navigating a series of visions and illusions before rebirth. But Tibetan practitioners always insisted it was more than that. They called it a manual for consciousness itself, a description not just of death, but of reality between states. The problem? The text is written in symbolic language, vivid, poetic, metaphorical. It speaks of wrathful deities, luminous voids, colored lights, and karmic winds. Traditional translators assume these were cultural metaphors, religious allegory. But what if they weren't? What if the monks were describing actual phenomena? That question remained unanswered until last year. In March 2023, a joint research initiative was quietly launched between the Mind and Life Institute, a neuroscience-focused organization co-founded by the Dalai Lama and DeepMind's Experimental Quantum Linguistics Division. The goal was ambitious: use a quantum AI system, trained not just on language, but on physics, to analyze the Bardo Thodol in its original Tibetan form, not to translate it word for word, but to map its conceptual architecture, to identify patterns invisible to human cognition. Dr. Alina Sonam, a linguist and quantum information researcher leading the project, described it this way in an internal memo. Classical computers process language sequentially. Quantum systems process it as a field, a web of entangled meanings. If the Bardo Thodol was composed by someone who experienced consciousness non-linearly, a quantum analysis might reveal structures we've been blind to for centuries. The AI was given the complete Tibetan manuscript, commentaries from 40 different lineages, modern neuroscience data on dying brain states, quantum mechanics models of entanglement and superposition. Then, it was asked a single question: what is this text describing? The answer came back in 14 hours. And it wasn't what anyone expected. The AI didn't just translate, it reconstructed, it identified repeating mathematical structures embedded in the text's grammar, ratios, symmetries, recursive loops that corresponded to known patterns in quantum field theory. Specifically, the 6 bardos described in the text, traditionally interpreted as stages of existence, mapped almost perfectly onto quantum state transitions. The luminous void mentioned repeatedly? The AI identified linguistic markers suggesting it wasn't metaphorical emptiness, but the quantum vacuum, the seething field of virtual particles that underlies all reality. The wrathful and peaceful deities described in vivid, terrifying detail? According to the AI's pattern analysis, they corresponded to fluctuating probability fields, eigenstates, nodes of collapse. In other words, observer-dependent phenomena. The text wasn't describing gods. It was describing what happens when a conscious observer encounters the quantum substrate of reality without a functioning sensory filter. Dr. Tenzin Wangyal, a Tibetan scholar collaborating on the project, put it bluntly. We think the monks were describing what consciousness experiences when the brain, the measurement apparatus, shuts down, when the observer becomes entangled with the field itself. But the most startling finding? The text predicted something modern physics only confirmed in 2022. In one passage of the Bardo Thodol, there's a description of what the consciousness principle experiences immediately after death. It's translated traditionally as, you will experience a radiance like the sky at dawn, vast, luminous, empty. Do not be afraid. This is your own true nature. Poetic, reassuring, abstract. But the quantum AI identified something embedded in the original Tibetan phrasing, a ratio. A precise numerical relationship between the terms used for radiance, vast, and emptiness. When converted to values, that ratio was 1.618, the golden ratio, the same proportion that governs spiral galaxies, DNA helixes, and quantum harmonic oscillators. But here's the eerie part. The passage continues. From this radiance, colored lights will arise. White, blue, yellow, red, green. Each represents a realm. Do not grasp them. They are illusions born of habit. The eye cross-referenced this with spectroscopy data. Those five colors correspond exactly to the emission spectra of hydrogen, helium, oxygen, nitrogen, and carbon, the five elements that make up 98% of the human body. It's as if the text is describing the quantum signature of biological dissolution. The moment the atoms that made you return to the field. Dr. Marcus Hale, a physicist at MIT who reviewed the findings, said in a private interview, "Either this is the most staggering coincidence in literary history, or someone in the 8th century had access to information that took us 1,200 years to discover." But the real revelation came from the final section. The last third of the Bardo Thodol describes what it calls the Bardo of becoming, the phase where consciousness, now untethered from the body, begins to search for a new form, a new birth. Western readers have always interpreted this as religious belief in reincarnation, but the quantum AI found something else, a schematic. The text describes a process by which the consciousness principle is drawn toward karmic imprints, patterns formed by past experiences, emotions, and choices. These imprints, the text says, literally shape what the consciousness perceives as reality. Sound familiar? In quantum mechanics, it's called the observer effect, the phenomenon where conscious measurement collapses. Probability waves into definite outcomes. The AI noted that the Tibetan term used, bagchags, doesn't just mean imprint. It means structural information encoded in a field. In modern terms, a quantum information state. The text goes further. It describes how consciousness, in this in-between state, can encounter doors, portals into different realms, different realities, different forms. But here's the twist. The text warns that you create the doors by observing them. If you perceive hell, you open the door to hell. If you perceive light, you enter light. The realms have no inherent existence. They arise from the nature of the perceiver. Dr. Alara Quinn, a consciousness researcher at UC Santa Barbara, noted, "This is shockingly similar to many worlds' interpretation in quantum mechanics, the idea that every observation branches reality. The text seems to suggest that consciousness, post-death, navigates a superposition of potential states and collapses them through observation." If the AI is right, the Bardo Thodol isn't a religious text. It's a field manual. A guide to navigating quantum reality when the brain, the biological anchor, is gone. This brings us to the question physics has avoided for a century. What is consciousness? Materialism says it's an emergent property of neurons, a byproduct of complexity. But quantum mechanics has always had a problem. The equations require an observer, something that collapses the wave, something that transforms possibility into reality. For decades, physicists have tried to define observer in non-conscious terms, measurement devices, decoherence, environmental interactions. But none of the models are complete. And now, a 1,000-year-old Tibetan text, analyzed by a machine designed to think in quantum states, is suggesting something radical. Consciousness isn't produced by matter. It's fundamental. A field. A property of the universe itself. And what we call life is just consciousness, localized in biological form. Death, then, isn't the end. its delocalization, the return of a local observer to the non-local field. Dr. Arjun Patel, a theoretical physicist involved in the project, said, "If this interpretation holds, even partially, it means the Tibetan monks weren't writing mythology. They were writing phenomenology. Direct reports of what consciousness experiences when it decouples from space-time. Of course, this raises more questions than it answers. If consciousness persists beyond death, where does it go? If it's observer-dependent, what does it observe when there are no eyes, no brain, no senses? The Bardothodol suggests the answer is simple. It observes itself. And in doing so, it creates the next reality. Not everyone is convinced." Dr. Lena Kowalski, a computational linguist at Stanford, argues that the AI may be finding patterns that aren't there, pareidolia at the algorithmic level. Quantum systems are prone to noise, and humans are prone to confirmation bias. Just because an AI identifies mathematical structures doesn't mean the original authors intended them. Language is messy. Meaning is subjective. Others point out that the Bardothodol has been translated, retranslated, and reinterpreted so many times that its original meaning may be impossible to recover. But Dr. Sonam counters, "We didn't use English translations. We used the oldest surviving Tibetan manuscripts, cross-referenced with oral lineages that have been unbroken for centuries. And the quantum AI wasn't programmed to find physics. It was programmed to find structure. The physics emerged on its own. Still, rigorous peer review is ongoing. The findings haven't been published in a major journal yet, but preliminary results were presented at the Science of Consciousness conference in Tucson this past April. The response? Silence. Then a standing ovation. Not because the findings were proven, but because for the first time, ancient contemplative traditions and quantum mechanics were being discussed in the same room, as equals. So what does this mean for us? For people living ordinary lives, far from particle accelerators and monastery meditation halls? Maybe nothing. Maybe everything. If the Bardothodol is even partially accurate, if consciousness really is a field, not a product, it changes how we think about death. It's no longer an ending. It's a phase transition. Like water turning to vapor, the substance remains, the form changes. And if our thoughts, our intentions, our habitual patterns really do shape what comes next, then every moment becomes an act of creation. Every choice. A quantum collapse. You're not just living a life, you're writing the code for what comes after. The Tibetan monks understood this. That's why they meditated. Not to escape reality, but to train the observer. To become conscious of consciousness itself. So that when the body falls away, the awareness remains stable. Calm. Unafraid. Modern neuroscience is beginning to catch up. Studies on long-term meditators show measurable changes in brain structure, thickening in areas related to attention, memory, and self-awareness. But more intriguing, studies on people who've had near-death experiences. Many describe the same phenomena the Bardothodol outlines: tunnels of light, life reviews, encounters with beings, a sense of timelessness. Dr. Bruce Grayson, a psychiatrist at UVA who studied NEDs for 50 years, says, "These experiences are consistent across cultures, ages, and belief systems. That suggests they're not constructed by culture. They're revealing something fundamental about consciousness itself. And now, for the first time, we have a framework, however speculative, that bridges the gap between science and spirituality, between the material and the transcendent, between the quantum and the divine. There's a larger pattern here. One that goes beyond the single text, a single culture, a single discovery. For the past 400 years, science and religion have been at war. Science said, show us evidence. Religion said, some truths transcend measurement. But quantum mechanics, strange, paradoxical, maddeningly non-intuitive, has forced science into uncomfortable territory. A territory where observation matters, where consciousness plays a role, where the act of knowing changes what is known. And now, ancient wisdom traditions, once dismissed as superstition, are being revisited. Not because they were right about everything, but because they were paying attention to something science ignored. subjective experience, the felt sense of being, the nature of awareness itself. The Bardo Thodol is just one example, but there are others. The Vedic texts describe Brahman, a universal field of consciousness underlying all reality. The Tao Te Ching describes the Tao, an unnameable source from which all things arise and to which all things return. Indigenous traditions around the world speak of the spirit world, a non-physical realm interpenetrating our own. For millennia, these were dismissed as mythology. But what if they were models? Early attempts to describe a reality that doesn't fit neatly into matter and energy. What if mystics, shamans, and monks were the first phenomenologists, explorers of consciousness, using the only tool they had, themselves? And what if now, armed with quantum computers, AI, and neuroscience, we're finally ready, Kishavche, to understand what they found? The translation project is ongoing. The quantum AI is now analyzing other texts, the Upanishads, the Egyptian Book of the Dead, Sufi poetry, Christian mystical writings. Researchers want to know, are the patterns consistent? Do other traditions describe the same underlying reality using different symbols? Preliminary results suggest yes, but the data is still being processed, and the implications are still being debated. Some say this could revolutionize our understanding of consciousness. Others say it's confirmation bias dressed in quantum jargon. But here's what we know for certain. A machine designed to simulate the universe at its most fundamental level was given a text written by humans exploring consciousness at its most fundamental level, and it found coherence. Mathematical, structural, undeniable. Whether that coherence reflects truth, or simply the limits of human perception, is a question we may never fully answer. But the fact that we're asking it, seriously, scientifically, humbly, is progress. There's a line near the end of the Bardo Thodol that the quantum AI flagged as statistically significant. It appears 17 times, in different forms, across the manuscript. Translated simply, it says, "Recognition is liberation. To recognize the light as your own nature is to be freed from illusion. To recognize the visions as projections is to be freed from fear. To recognize the mind as the creator of reality is to become conscious." Maybe that's the real revelation. Not that death is an illusion, not that consciousness survives, but that awareness itself, pure, unfiltered, direct, is the only constant, the only thing that was never born and can never die. The monks knew this. The mystics knew this. And now a quantum computer is starting to glimpse it too. We are not machines that became conscious. We are consciousness that learned to dream in matter. And when the dream ends, we wake up, not into nothingness, but into everything. If mysteries like this pull at something inside you, if you want to keep exploring the edges where science meets the unexplainable, subscribe, because we're just beginning to ask the right questions, and the universe has always been listening.